Kubernetes Failure Stories. My name is Henning. I'm responsible for developer experience at Zalando. And I will not tell you what Zalando is. I hope, like most of you, are from Europe, so you know that we sell fashion online. We grew quite fast. So I started 2010, and last year we already had 5.4 billion revenue. So this is kind of, yeah, you would call it unicorn in the European tech scene. But let's not talk so much about our organization and business, but about our scale and failure stories. So we have quite a lot of AWS accounts. This is not because we create so many clusters. As you can see, we have also a lot of clusters, but not as many as accounts. But before we started with Kubernetes, we created one AWS account per team. So that's why we nearly have 400 AWS accounts. And we have a lot of clusters. And we have a lot of developers. So we have 1,500 developers roundabout. And most of them have Kubernetes access. So this is kind of all the developers. And you can see most of them are blue with Kubernetes access. There are some who have AWS access, so not Kubernetes, not on Kubernetes yet. And there are also some gray people who don't have any like cloud access. These are, for example, mobile developers or similar. So a lot of clusters, a lot of developers, and also a lot of cluster components. So this is our public GitHub repo. You can find this. I'll post a link later. This is hard to read. But as you can see, this is a lot of different folders. And all these different folders contain different components you deploy to Kubernetes. So like external DNS, like custom operators, and so on. So a lot of different clusters, a lot of developers, a lot of different components. So this is definitely going to fail at some point. So incidents are fine. And I brought you today 9 incidents, or 9 failure stories. So we have an off by one error, of course. So I start with 0 today. And let's start with the first one. I always start with the impact. And then we follow the trail of clues leading to, hopefully, the contributing factors. So the first one is not so much like customer impact, but internal impact. So this was in our build system. Basically, this is build pods. And this is hot in this room. So I also signal like fire and failing things with a small flame here. So this is failing build pods in one cluster. And this doesn't really look so good. And what was really happening here is that in the end, pods were not working in this cluster. And why that? So in the end, these pods needed AWS IAM credentials. So we are running on AWS, like I mentioned earlier. And they were timing out and like were never really working. How this works on AWS, so you can use different components, but one of the default components on AWS to get IAM credentials on Kubernetes is using kube2IAM or k2IAM or similar. But they all rely on this IP tables redirect, and they rely on kubelet barely also updating the pod status correctly. And what was happening is that kubelet was falling behind for minutes. So minutes is kind of a long time frame. And this happened because actually there's a built-in rate limit in kubelet to the API server. And this is pretty low, the default value. So it's just 5 requests per second. And I wonder why we didn't run into this earlier. But in this case, we ran into this problem. And due to rescaling, basically a lot of pods landed on the same node. And all these pods were had rapid creation and deletion because of this build pod nature. So in the end, the fix is really simple. You configure the kubelet to use a different QPS. This is this kubelet config YAML. And you see there is this event QPS and also kube API QPS. So the default is 5. We just set it to 50 now. I heard yesterday or the day before from someone who set it to 100. So it depends on your org. OK, so this was a smaller incident, but it already tells you there are some knobs to tweak. And unless you really run into these problems, you might not have known that there is actually this setting and even this low setting by default. And so this was a learning, and this was just a few weeks ago. Let's come to the first incident, or the second, depends on off by one. And this is real customer impact. So we sell fashion online. And of course, you need to pay us, right? So this is how we make business. Guess what? So, and in Germany, the most common payment method is actually invoice. There are also others like direct debit, credit card, et cetera. And what was happening here is this offering rate. So the blue one is invoice. And you can see that this is kind of highly fluctuating. So there is something wrong. And what is actually wrong is that people could not see invoice as a payment method and some other risky payment methods. Because, of course, stuff where you pay later is risky for us. So it's a business decision if we offer this to customers or not. So might be that you don't get invoice for the first time. And this was badly not working. And the RIST service was badly not working. And we are losing money when we don't offer the right payment methods. If we look in the cluster where this risk evaluation is running, we see this chart. I will have this more than once today. This is ingress HTTP errors. So you see green is status 200, and then red is 500, and yellow is 400. And this is my screensaver, by the way. And so what people were getting is actually this 502 error. So clients calling this risk service were getting a 502 error. And this 502 error was not such just any 502 error. It was actually this 502 error. So it tells you server AWS ELB. So it's the ALB version 2 or the ELB 2. So ALB, application load balancer. And this was getting this or returning this error. So let's see in CloudWatch. We can actually see that this black line, the black line is healthy host of the ALB, were going to zero. So there were no healthy host in the application load balancer at that time. We don't see a real spike in requests. So this is also curious, right? You could say there is some overload or some like whatever denial of service. But this is also not happening. We just see there are no healthy host. How is our ingress setup looking like? So our ingress setup looks like this. So we have the cluster nodes at the bottom. We have TLS termination on the top with ALB. And then the ALB goes to our skipper, which is our open source HTTP router, and then goes to the My App. And what was happening in our case is when we look at skipper, at memory graph, that it basically bumps to, goes up to the memory limit, and then you can see missing data points where the flame is shown here. So badly skipper, the HTTP proxy was down, and then we bumped the limit to fix this. So what's happening is OM kill on the skipper endpoint, and then ALB had no endpoints to talk to. So why that? So there was no request spike, nothing really looking strange from what we saw so far, apart from that it's not working. So what was actually happening is we have this shared ingress per cluster, and there was a totally unrelated app. So in this RISC cluster, there's also a Solr running. This is not totally related to the incoming cluster request for customers. And these Solr components underwent a migration at that time and they had slow requests, so they had high latency. And what is happening is actually this ingress proxy gets this request, has a slow latency, and every request takes some memory, so it's actually not so much, it's Go routines, but this was causing this OM kill. So actually low, high latency apps in your cluster, depending on your HTTP proxy, can cause a complete outage. So we fixed this now with a so-called LIFO queue. So this is now in the open source version also. Okay, number two. Let's start with customer impact. So we see errors again. This time it was on the product detail page. So this is the product detail page. And if this errors, then people cannot buy. We also see 404 errors. This is in a different cluster. This is our IAM infrastructure. So we have OAuth for service-to-service communication, and this IAM infrastructure was returning 404. We also see in this cluster where IAM is running that the pods are spiking. So we see normally 400 pods, and then it goes up to 3,000, and this doesn't really look good. So remember, we have this ingress setup I already showed earlier. And how this works is that skipper also needs to update routes. So it reads routes from the API server, from ingress. And what was happening in this case, pods were exploding. What happens in the API server? API server returns all pods when someone asks for it. And if you have too much of it, then the API server is OM killed. And this was what happened. And this can cause be caused by any kind of objects. So in Kubernetes, watch out. We also had a different incident. If you have some resources which are basically piling up and the API server tries to return it because someone asked for it, then you might have an OM kill of the API server. So this was happening. And skipper was then barely not being able to update routes and failing. What was causing this high number of pods? YAML, of course. So this is the wrong YAML. And I don't know if you are familiar with Kubernetes manifest. The correct one would look like this. So wrong, correct one. So actually, was just at the wrong place, was not really validated at that time. So this is already, I think, 2 years ago. But there is this history limit, and you want to have some limit. And in the old cron job, there was no limit. So cron job pods were piling up like hell. So of course we should be more resilient to this behavior, but you should also watch out that you're not exceeding your capacity in your cluster. So at that time we added this resource quota with 1,500 pods so that we know that this would still work. Incident number three. So again, this I already showed earlier, ingress errors, 500 going up, 200 going down, some 400. In this case, this is an interesting one because it's always DNS, and in this case, it's core DNS. So core DNS, our cluster DNS, former times this was kube DNS, doesn't really matter. In this case, it's core DNS. I don't really have good graphs because I have to scrape everything from our postmortems. So this is basically OM killer killing core DNS. This is the Prometheus graph for the restarts of core DNS. And this doesn't look good. So we see real impact, the whole ingress going down. We see DNS dying. And we try to fix it. So stop the bleeding, bump memory limits. OK, we first bump it to 1 GB and bump it to more. And it still doesn't really help at the, with the first bump. What was causing this? Spike in HTTP requests. So spike in HTTP requests, that's the best graph I could find, causing spike in DNS requests, spike in memory for the core DNS. So why? First of all, there was something going on with HTTP retries. So our client app, in this case was JavaScript, was actually constantly retrying. So it was making things worse and not backing off. There was no DNS caching, so we had a lot of DNS requests from this different HTTP request. And there is something called N.5 in Kubernetes. Who here knows what N.5 is? OK, the others are too tired to raise their hand or don't know. But if you don't know and run Kubernetes or want to run Kubernetes, then at least look up what N.5 means. Because what N.5 means, it's not a Kubernetes thing per se. It's like a resolveconf setting, which leads to when you think you do one DNS request, you might have 10 requests, actually. So N.5 is definitely a problem. Then we had a short lifetime of HTTP requests, and memory limit for core DNS is, of course, fixed. And monitoring was also affected, so that's why I don't have good graphs. There is also a deeper postmortem here. Number four. So this is data points for this cluster, and this looks not good because there are no data points, so the cluster is down. And who can tell me what this is doing if we delete something in etcd? So if we do RM, A, and F, or RM, A, and B, and minus F, right, force, then you would expect it deletes A and B, if this is folders, and you force it to. But what this does is actually you delete everything between key and range end. So actually, the person who wanted to do it wanted to delete two things. But this command is not really intuitive. So it deletes everything lexicographically from key to range end. So it's really not a good CLI design, I would say. And it's still like this. So don't use etcd control without consulting the help page first. But there is this very good talk here, which I can recommend from Kate from SREcon. So if you need a senior engineer to basically double check what you're doing in production, then you might also do something wrong. So junior engineers are also a feature. This is the talk title. And so yes, we should not really believe that human error is something we fix by talking with more humans and applying rules, but we should have systematic fixes. So in this case, of course, disaster recovery plan, fixing the underlying issue that we don't need to delete anything, and monitoring all the snapshots to etcd. Number five, this is latency spikes in one cluster for the API server. So this is API server, should normally be fast, right, a few milliseconds. And this now goes up to a 1 second. And what was going on here? So how this looks is that we have an API server talking to etcd. And this is a quote from this postmortem. So basically, Kubernetes worker and master nodes sporadically fail to connect to etcd and causing timeouts, and even causing timeouts in the pod network because we use Flannel, which was backed by etcd at that point. So we didn't really figure out what was going on. So first of all, we stopped the bleeding. So how do you stop the bleeding? If you know that restarting things helps, you do something like this, cron job or something. And if it fails, we restart etcd member. So this was going on for weeks. We restart etcd member, and then everything works again. Then we finally get some confirmation from AWS that actually There is something strange with T2 instances. So at that time, you used etcd on T2 instances. And we don't explicitly recommend against running production services on T2. So if anybody can of you tell me what this really means, should we now use T2 or not? I don't know, but this is like AWS answer. So definitely T2 was a problem. We switched away from T2. And learning is, it's never really AWS infrastructure until it is. And T2 instances should be treated with care. So there might be like network hiccups with T2 instances. And but the most important learning is here that actually the single drop packets, so this was a single the packet dropped, reset packet, was causing this outages. And this tells us that actually also the core Kubernetes components are not cloud native, because should be resilient and declarative, dynamic, and scalable. And this was not really resilient. So connections were hanging, and they were never really reestablished. Number six, we see ingress errors again, this time a CloudWatch screenshot, 500 errors again, our favorite HTTP status code today. And we see another graph where we don't see any data points for this cluster. So this is also telling us that the cluster might be down or our monitoring. And there is a trigger. There is a PR which merges stuff from dev to alpha, which I explain in a moment. And we actually change the flannel backend. Remember, this colleague should not be really the cause of this, right? Human error is never the cause. Let's have a quick look at the cluster upgrade flow. So all our cluster configuration is on GitHub. If we upgrade something, we do a PR, we test everything, and then move it through the different channels. We have a different component for this called Cluster Lifecycle Manager, who does all this. So it updates CloudFormation and Kubernetes manifests. And basically, we move everything between different channels. So we start with dev, then go to alpha, beta, stable. And this basically was a move from dev to alpha. So from the first level to the next channel. And we also do end-to-end tests. So this should be fine. But what was actually going on? So we did this change of a flannel backend. We did a PR. There are end-to-end tests. But the end-to-end test looked like this. So we create a new cluster, run end-to-end tests with all the conformance tests, official one and our custom one, and then they delete the cluster. What is missing here? Yes, the upgrade pass. So this was totally fine, this PR, working with a completely new cluster, but it was not working with a cluster with the existing configuration and then updating it. So what we needed to do and what we have now is basically we need to create a cluster on end-to-end test, update the cluster, so create the cluster with the old version, update the cluster, run end-to-end test, and then delete the cluster to really test the upgrade pass. I mean, everybody who does DB migration scripts and use Flyway or whatnot like knows this migration topic and update pass, but we didn't do this before. But we already had end-to-end tests and were quite confident, which was not so helpful in this case. So end-to-end tests are pretty good, but maybe we should also really test the end-to-end upgrade pass. And by the way, the whole end-to-end tests are here on GitHub. So this is the official conformance test plus custom test. And it's not so easy to find how to do it in Kubernetes land. So in our repo, there's a README how to do it. So you can also run the official conformance test for your clusters and extend them if you need to. So number seven. This is out of memory again. Out of memory, also one of the favorite contributing factors. And this is a kernel reaper going around. And this is just from our chat. And way to go, kubelet. Kubelet takes 9 GB of memory. And yeah, in the end, all containers on this node are down because the OM reaper is going around. This is a graph of kubelet memory. So kubelet going over to 10 GB doesn't really look healthy. We created the upstream issue for 1.12.5. We observed failing nodes, so this was always very consistent. So after a few days, basically kubelet was going to this 10 GB of memory, and kubelet eating all memory. And the patch looks like this. So it's just removing one line. And the line is set reflector matrix provider, something like this. And basically what was going on is there is this automatic reflector matrix in Kubernetes. And this was causing in 1.12.5, in a certain condition, when you use Hypercube, import of Go pass was basically enabling reflector matrix. And then basically kubelet exploded with memory. So this was upstream issue. And we were surprised that we hit this. Because, I mean, are we the only ones running 1.12.5? But then we found out that this is only in combination with Hypercube when you basically have all the different Kubernetes components in one binary. It's a side effect of Go import, which is really funny. So you can read the Kubernetes issue here. Number eight is something during pod creation. So if you deploy something, you might want to get credentials. In our case, we use OAuth for service to service. So you might want to get OAuth credentials. And in this case, all these Kubernetes deployments failed because the credentials could not be provisioned. If you look in the application who provisions these credentials, so these credentials are provisioned as secrets, you see this queue size, and this queue size going up and going up, and this is normally zero, so it goes to 58K. And then we look at CPU throttling and resources of this app, and this I showed yesterday in my short substitute talk. So what was happening is we have limits, resource limits, CPU, so this is only CPU, and the green one is usage, and the usage never really reaches the limit. So it looks fine that we reduce limit and requests. And this is what we did. And then we see exploding CPU throttling. So CPU throttling is on the right y-axis in percentage. And you would expect this is not going like to 100%, but it actually does. So basically the whole Kubernetes is, or the whole app is blocked by CPU throttling. So what was the background? We tried to scale down this limit and request and to reduce slack. And in the end, the credentials could not be processed fast enough. What is slack? Slack, I call something which is the difference between usage and requests. So request, when it is resource request, block resources on nodes, and you often use less. And this is the difference, is basically slack. And you want to reduce slack to save costs. So we try to save costs, reduce resource requests and limits, and this lead to this incident. What we learned later on by also going to KubeCon Copenhagen is that actually some people recommend disabling CPU throttling altogether, and this is what we did. So we now have CPU throttling disabled in all our clusters, and this also helps with latencies. And there are some more problems with this whole CPU throttling, why you want to or might want to disable it. Now on Twitter there are some threats, so there are more and more companies actually disabling CPU throttling. So this is Thomas from Düsseldorf, I don't remember the company, they disabled it. MyTaxi, I think, disabled it, and some others. And also you see here Tim Hocken, one of the core Kubernetes people, he badly actually says, always set memory limits equals requests and never set CPU limits or disable CPU throttling. So this is maybe my takeaway for you. Just look into if it makes sense for you. So there are a lot of other ways to crash stuff. Docker daemon, I heard there was one talk today from Singh. I have to watch it later on, also about Docker problems. So Docker is always painful. There is this whole DNS topic and DNS latency issues. So we switch from kubedns to node local DNS mask plus core DNS. And there, if anybody tells you 5 second latencies they observe, and this is one developer, then you might tell him, no, this is not true because you see it only once. But then probably this is this problem, and believe him if someone sees 5 seconds DNS latencies. CPU throttling to disable, at least from my side, I can recommend this. And there are a lot of problems with client Go. Some are now fixed, but a lot of them are not yet fixed. 502s during cluster upgrades, so there are race conditions and whatnot. There are graceful shutdowns to be made, and this is also tricky if you have different tech stacks. So either you tell everyone how to do this for all the different tech stacks, or you create something like a template for all your apps. There are incompatible Kubernetes changes. So actually, we had, this was not so often the case, but once there was this read-only config map and read-only secrets, which was a bug that they were writable, so you could write to the volume of config map and secret, and actually they fixed it. But if you have 200 teams, then you can be sure that someone uses this bug as a feature, so this was what happened, and we overlooked this. And Container Linux stable might not boot. I mean, Container Linux is now partly dead, so it's not really an issue anymore. EBS volume handling is definitely a huge pain on AWS. Now it got much better with Kubernetes. And Docker is always Docker and Docker and Docker. There are race conditions, so favorite takes from race conditions. This is a GitHub repo, our GitHub repo, and you see sleep 120. So if you see this, you know something is fishy. So this is still there, I believe. And you also see this in other apps, so it's not only us. Using a proxy to connect to yeah, it's a deep proxy just to fix timeouts, which the client doesn't bring in. It's also a little bit fishy, but it works as a workaround. Then you might ask, managed Kubernetes might help us, right? I mean, Lotse provides Kubematic, and a lot of different cloud providers provide it. So let's have a quick look at EKS. EKS has SLA of 99.9%. So this really looks good, right? So we can pretty sure that AWS EKS would help us. GKE also has some uptime percentage, not really SLA, but also some promise. But in the end, if you look at through the incidents, then this managed Kubernetes would not have really helped us. First of all, EKS, really look into the fine print. The whole SLA is only for the API server. And yeah, look at our incidents. So the API server was not really the issue. The issue is always the other components and always the interaction of all the different things together. So I would say partly helped us, at least for deleting stuff in etcd. This we cannot do if it's managed. But apart from that, a lot of things are still to consider. And if you look at EKS, there's this nice blog post, production proofing EKS. I mean, it also slowly gets better, but there's still a lot of things to look at. Maybe they fix it now. There was barely no Docker log rotation, for example. Yeah, you can just look at the list. So it's not that you get a production proof thing out of the box. And I told you the DNS thing. DNS is definitely something you would or should look into, how you scale with that. And in EKS, this was actually just one DNS port, which yeah, doesn't really scale. I think now it's two by default. But anyway, if you run an AWS or wherever you run, definitely look into how you scale DNS inside your cluster, whether you use Node Local, Core DNS, whatnot, as this might really, if DNS doesn't work, you have a problem. And also, big cloud providers like GKE have this favorite or infamous scripts, right? So if Docker daemon does not respond in 10 seconds, kill the Docker daemon. So it's also a solution. I mean, you would expect better, but that's how other cloud providers try to handle this. And I mean, you can look it up. Okay, so in the end, welcome to Cloud Native. And yeah, my colleague Mikkel also has a nice Twitter description, so writing Kubernetes-related postmortems for Zalando Tech. So yes, if you want to join Zalando and write postmortems, you're welcome. And you're also welcome to contribute your own failure stories. I didn't hear any Istio production failure stories yet. I was in talk today about Istio, but this is also not production yet. So definitely looking for more failure stories. Check this list there. There are very good talks. For example, one talk by Datadog on KubeCon. I can recommend, and just look through the items, and depending on your cloud provider, there might be stuff you just want to check out if you really made sure this will work. And of course, a big disclaimer, someone added a PR to my failure stories. Don't use this list to not use Kubernetes. So I don't know if I really need to add this disclaimer, so it's I didn't merge this. But yes, I mean, then this would be confirmation bias. So if you just look at this, just because I created this list of failure stories that Kubernetes is not working, this might also be the wrong conclusion. But definitely look into the different failure scenarios. There are all the different open source tools out there. So here's a complete list. And yes, I really don't want to keep you longer in this hot atmosphere, so feel free to ask me any questions. Otherwise, I'm still around. Thank you.